Thank you, my honorable chairpersons, Dr. Sanjay Das and Dr. Suresh Babu. I sincerely thank the SEB organizers for giving me an opportunity to be amongst these august bodies. And my task is to sensitize you all about the repurposing of anti-diabetic drugs for management of neurodegenerative disorders. It is important that the question of are neurodegenerative disorders and type 2 diabetes are linked. It's a question which is now going to be resolved over the last 15 years of research. And now we know that there are a lot of epidemiologic data linking Alzheimer's disease and type 2 diabetes. One of the first reports to provide strong evidence that patients with type 2 diabetes are at a significantly increased risk of developing Alzheimer's disease was the Rotterdam study, which was published way back in 1999 in the Neurology Journal. And that produced a lot of changes in understanding that most of the dementia in diabetic subjects may not be vascular, and there could be Alzheimer's disease, which is purely neurodegenerative. At the same time, I am not giving way to some thoughts by some workers that there is a combination of the two, vascular insufficiency as well as degeneration. This prospective cohort study in Rotterdam study, but it recruited 6,370 elderly subjects, found that the presence of diabetes almost doubled the risk of developing Alzheimer's disease. The risk of Alzheimer's disease was even higher among patients treated with insulin, with a group which can have a longer history of diabetes and may be refractory to oral agents. Several other large studies may also have investigated the relationship of Alzheimer's disease and elevated glucose levels, impaired glucose tolerance, diabetes, and systemic review and meta-analysis of these studies reported similar overall findings. Blood is positively associated with accelerated cognitive decline, even among individuals without clinical diabetes. And therefore, there is an increased risk of Alzheimer's disease dementia with each serial increase in glucose level through the entire spectrum of possible glucose levels. There are a lot of evidences which shows that insulin signaling abnormalities in the brain takes place in people suffering from Alzheimer's disease. The postmodern studies of Alzheimer's disease have demonstrated reduced insulin receptor expression and reduced cytosolic levels of phosphoinositol 3K subunits of P85 alpha and P110 alpha, which are extremely consistent with insulin resistance. Cellular insulin resistance and insulin insufficiency is occurring in the brain in Alzheimer's disease is becoming evident, including in those without systemic diabetes. The patients who are having Alzheimer's disease do have some abnormalities in metabolizing and consuming glucose, and there is gross defects of insulin signaling abnormalities. The researchers sometimes were enthusiastic enough to term Alzheimer's disease as type 3 diabetes. This is a heat map showing abnormal phosphorylation of multiple insulin signaling which are there in the postmodern hippocampal brain tissue from 24 matched human Alzheimer's disease. The left side panel, there are normal controls. On the right side, there are Alzheimer's cases. And there is a lot of changes of insulin signaling proteins in the form of abnormal phosphorylation, which have been unveiled in the postmodern studies. Pathogenesis models of abnormal brain insulin signaling in Alzheimer's disease. As we all know that the pathogenesis of Alzheimer's today focus on amyloid beta production and aggregation on the extracellular site, and to a lesser degree, hyperphosphorylated tau fibrillation with plaque formation inside the cell in neurites and neurofibrillary tangles, leading to synaptic loss, cell death, and cognitive dysfunction. Although the data linking abnormal insulin signaling in Alzheimer's disease in epidemiological studies, animal studies, and human postmodern studies are compelling, but it is not sure that the insulin signaling dysfunction relates to other aspects of Alzheimer's disease pathology, and cognitive decline remains somewhat unclear. though there are a lot of researches taking place in different parts of the world. This is the link between the brain insulin resistance and cognitive deficits. If you look into the neural and function, you will be able to appreciate that the neural structure and function changes to take place in patients who develop brain insulin resistance. There is diminution of the brain-derived neurotrophic factor, and there is also diminution of the dendritic spines. These are the postsynaptic areas protrusion, which has got an immense role in synaptic transmission, which gives rise to memory as well as learning. So the mitochondrial dysfunction is also another, which gives rise to increased reactive oxygen species production and oxidative stress, and there is diminution of the ATP production. And on top of that, there is also inflammation, and this inflammation is associated with increased cytokine levels as well as microglial activation. So all these in the form of inflammation, in the form of mitochondrial dysfunction, and neuronal structure and function changes do translate into the cognitive deficits. Type 2 diabetes, brain insulin resistance, and Alzheimer's disease have been linked in a number of different epidemiological, clinical, and animal studies. You'll be able to appreciate in this particular chart, which was published way back in 2014, that type 2 diabetes and the metabolic syndrome can be contributed by genes and the amount of factors, which has got some immense role in developing and perpetuating the inflammation, lipid homeostasis, and insulin signaling defects, which invites brain insulin resistance. And type 2 diabetes and metabolic syndrome through inflammation, hyperinsulinemia, and inhibition of insulin degrading enzymes, microvascular disease, oxidative stress, and advanced glycation end products all give rise to increased brain insulin resistance, and also formation of the amyloid beta plaques and phosphorylation of the tau proteins. And they are all associated with impaired synaptic plasticity, synaptic degeneration, as well as cell death, which contribute to cognitive decline and Alzheimer's disease. If we look into the Parkinson's disease, which is the second most common neurodegenerative disorder after Alzheimer's disease, the pathophysiological mechanism of Parkinson's disease that may favor development of diabetes may be mitochondrial dysfunction, alpha-synuclein, PINK1 and DJ1, and they favor the development of type 2 diabetes. Same is true about the pathophysiological mechanism of type 2 diabetes that may favor the development of Parkinson's disease. Metabolic inflammation, downregulation of dopamine, long-term hyperglycemia, PGC1-alpha, PEDPA15, methyl dioxal, alpha-synuclein, which invites amyloid fibrils, they all give rise to Parkinson's disease. It is important that we need to understand that the researchers are now thinking heavily about repurposing diabetes drugs for brain insulin resistance in neurodegenerative disorders. Alzheimer's disease didn't have any new molecule for treatment since 2002, when they all started from anticholinesterase inhibition, and this cholinesterase inhibition is the seed anchor of treatment till now, and they are quite effective in alleviating symptoms to some extent, but in the long term, they have not addressed the pathophysiological defects, and thus they have not been found to be quite fruitful over a period of time. And we know stage 2 Alzheimer's disease and stage 3 Alzheimer's disease are associated with dependency, and the dependency on the family member as well as the society at large, as the people are living longer, that is posing a huge burden. So all diabetic drugs are likely to have indirect effects in the CNS by affecting the circulating concentration of glucose and insulin. If insulin is available there and in the brain it is being utilized in the form of glucose utilization, then it is possible that this amyloid beta production as well as the neurofibrillary tangle productions, which are the chief pathological changes that occur in Alzheimer's disease, may be reduced to some extent. Here you can see the GLP-1 receptor agonist, the insulin receptor, which is being modulated by exogenous insulin, or methyl leptin or pramlintide. They do have different ways of interfering with the different kinases, and metformin affecting the AMP kinase has got a significant role in the downstream regulation of different cascades. Anti-diabetic drugs in Parkinson's disease has also now been studied extensively, and it is now being shown that hazelnutrin, metformin, and intranasal insulin have got some significant influence on glucose metabolism distribution, insulin signaling distribution, insulin resistance alleviation, and mitochondrial dysfunction reduction. All these are associated with diminution of the changes that do take place in the substantia nigra in the form of loss of microsatellite dopaminergic neurons, Lewy bodies, reduction, motor symptoms improvement, and cognitive defects. We all know that aging is one of the risk factors of Parkinson's disease, and same is type 2 diabetes. Intranasal insulin has been studied extensively, and this intranasal intake of insulin improved consolidation of words and general mood indicating intranasal insulin as a potential treatment in patients showing cognitive deficits in conjunction with the lack of insulin. So once you deliver insulin in the intranasal route, you deliver insulin through the blood-brain barrier, and thereby the systemic effects of insulin is obviated to a gross extent, avoiding hypoglycemia, avoiding peripheral hyperinsulinemia. And acute administration of intranasal insulin enhances functional connectivity between the dorsal medial prefrontal cortex of the default mode network and the hippocampus in healthy, lean, overweight, as well as obese adults. Although this study missed examination on cognitive function, but there are definitely some improvement of the metabolic status. Previous research studies have evaluated the cognitive beneficial effect of intranasal insulin therapy in non-schizophrenia patients. Adjunctive intranasal insulin administration was safe, well-tolerated, and effective as a measure of executive function in bipolar disorder. Now, more and more studies are revealing that the schizophrenia as well as bipolar disorders, they do have the different pathophysiology, but ultimately they do have the shrinkage of the brain volume, and there is significant cell loss which are associated with cognitive decline in neuropsychiatric patients. So they are being also extensively studied. Systemic reviews also suggested that intranasal insulin administration might have a beneficial effect on cognitive function in amnestic MCI patients with Alzheimer's disease, probably modified by APOE4 allele carrier status. A pilot clinical trial demonstrated that 4-month intranasal insulin treatment stabilized or improved cognition, function, and cerebral glucose metabolism for adults with amnestic mild cognitive impairment and Alzheimer's disease. Metformin, through its effect on aging, reduction of neurodegenerative disorder, is also very much welcome. And now it has been shown to have reduction of inflammation, antioxidation. There is AMPK activation. Neurogenesis is favored. Reduced excitotoxicity, reduced mitochondrial dysfunction. In metformin, there are certain dubious studies. In some studies, they do show some performance improvement. In some studies, they fail to do unveil that metformin may be beneficial because of the short duration, because of the small number of patients, because of the duration of that Alzheimer's disease, there could be some misleading outcome. In patients with amnestic mild cognitive impairment or non-diabetic subjects with mild cognitive impairment or mild dementia, due to Alzheimer's disease, metformin treatment was associated with promising cognitive enhancement. But this particular Mayo Clinic study, which shows some increased risk of mild cognitive impairment, that was not associated with cognitive test performance. With the pathway and function of insulin receptor activation, you can well appreciate that all these particular cascade of insulin receptor associated, they do have some improvement of cell growth, synapse growth, repair and regeneration, and neuronal development, neuroprotection, and memory formation is one of the important area of concern which can be achieved through functions of insulin receptor activation at the level of the brain. Activity of GLP-1 in neurons have been now understood in a greater detail. Adenylate cyclase formation, which has been interfered with cyclic AMP, gives rise to PKA activation. And all these cascade gives rise to improvement of cell growth, synapse growth, repair and regeneration. And thus, GLP-1 receptor agonism at the level of the brain may be associated with neuroprotection, neuronal development, and memory function. GLP-1 receptor agonists, systemic review demonstrated, GLP-1 receptor agonists induce the weight loss and improve fasting glucose and A1C in schizophrenia patients who were overweight or obese. Once daily subcutaneous injection for 16 weeks of liraglutide improved glucose tolerance and weight gain in clozapine and olanzapine treated schizophrenia patients who were overweight and pre-diabetes compared with controls. Liraglutide exhibited pro-cognitive effects in individuals with mood disorder in a 4-week open-label study which has been published in 2017. While 3 months treatment with exenatide 2 mg once weekly failed to improve cognition, there are certain thoughts that in midlife individuals at risk of Alzheimer's disease, there was an inverse correlation between insulin resistance and connectivity between the bilateral hippocampal and anterior medial frontal structure, which are first to be affected in Alzheimer's disease. However, the enhancement in connectivity after liraglutide treatment does not accompany with improved cognitive function. Arbulin dance has also shown some significant promise because of the PPAR gamma agonism, which are associated with different receptor activation at different cellular levels, and including the brain. They have got some dubious results, particularly initially rosiglitazone was tried extensively, but we all know that this is a banned drug now, and the only member of the PPAR gamma agonist is the pioglitazone. And systemic review, including 9 eligible studies, suggested that there was insufficient evidence to support the cognitive benefits of rosiglitazone in Alzheimer's disease and amnestic mild cognitive impairment patients. Although the efficacy of pioglitazone was promising in patients with comorbid diabetes, SGLT2 inhibitors dapagliflozin could improve brain insulin sensitivity, alleviate brain mitochondrial dysfunction, attenuate brain apoptosis and brain inflammation, and preserve hippocampal synaptic plasticity. However, no sufficient preclinical and powered clinical studies have elucidated the cognitive benefit of SGLT2 inhibitors in Alzheimer's disease and schizophrenia. Let me tell you that in 2020, one metformin study has been undertaken. That's the MAP study.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. You have 2 more minutes left.
Yes, yes. Thank you. So the study is called the MAP study. While metformin on Alzheimer's progression MAP study is undertaken in 2020, and we will be able to know from this randomized controlled trial on metformin in Alzheimer's progression MAP study. Another study I want to mention here is the ELERT study, efficacy of liraglutide in Alzheimer's disease, ELERT. And another study which have been announced in the last month by the Novo Nordisk people about the usefulness of semaglutide in 2 different studies. One is the EVOKE study. EVOKE study is for Alzheimer's disease patients with diabetes or without diabetes. And EVOKE 2 study, which is there for patients who have already sustained a stroke. Dapagliflozin has also started a clinical trial in early 2021. And I feel all these 4 studies stemming from metformin, liraglutide, dapagliflozin, and of late the semaglutide will be able to tell us a lot about the efficacy of different class of agents in varied neurodegenerative and neuropsychiatric disorders, particularly emphasizing on the efficacy in Alzheimer's. In conclusion, insulin resistance is a shared metabolic comorbidity of these 2 chronic diseases, which is evolving heavily in the elderly population all over the globe. Diabetes type 2, glucose intolerance of any severity, pre-diabetes, as well as the neurodegenerative diseases, mainly Alzheimer's, which produces 60% of the neurodegenerative diseases as a cause of dementia. The disruption of insulin action in the brain is considered as a potential as a physiological mechanism of cognitive impairment via deficits in neuronal structure and function, impaired synaptic plasticity, brain mitochondrial dysfunction, increased oxidative stress and inflammation. Intrinsic abnormal glucose metabolism would predispose Alzheimer's disease and schizophrenia patients to cognitive deficits, and current therapeutic measures cannot achieve expected therapeutic efficacy. Anti-diabetic agents have gained public and scientific attention for its potential as a cognitive enhancement drug, and is currently being examined in vitro experiments in preclinical animal studies and clinical trials around the world. The molecular mechanism and the preclinical animal model suggest that the repositioning of the antidiabetic drug is a promising opportunity to alleviate cognitive deficits in Alzheimer's disease and schizophrenia. A better understanding of the relationship between brain insulin resistance and cognitive impairment will help us to design future research and alleviate the problem in greater detail. Thank you very much.